Heavenly Father, I humbly beseech you to see before you a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, and a sinner of your own redeeming. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Good afternoon. It is a joy to be with you, our friends, old and friends to be here in the Diocese of Fort Worth, and I am grateful to your standing committee and to your bishop for the invitation to be with you and to offer a few words on this day as you all begin to gather for your business at Diocesan Council. Now, it's always important for me to try and understand the context a little bit for where I am going and where I am to be. And since we are neighbors, but I really didn't know a whole lot about Fort Worth, so I did a little bit of research. And so I'm going to say some things because they're... No, I didn't do that kind of... Y'all are giggling. I didn't do that kind of research. And many of you already know this story, but I found it interesting that Fort Worth is, of course, named after the U.S. Army General William Worth, right? Who, after the Mexican-American War, decided that we needed 10 forts across the wilderness to protect the frontier. And it was actually William Haney who found the spot at the confluence where the East and West Forks came together into the Trinity, and he built a fort, set it up there, but he decided he'd move it a little bit, so he went up on the bluff, and then it only lasted for a few years, and then they decided they didn't need the fort anymore, so the people took over, and they built stores, a Dagger store, that first big department store, and they built a school, and the city began to grow, and as I read through the history, it really became clear that Fort Worth has been, in all of these years, a place where two things seem to come together, and where there is a confluence, because you have certainly had in Fort Worth, over its history, like most Texas cities, your good times and your bad times. And like most Texans, you've had your good times and your bad times. But those forks have often come together, and there has been a great confluence. So as I prayed and I thought about our time together today, I wanted to ask this question: why, people of the Diocese of Fort Worth, why do you exist? Why is it that you have your being as a missionary Episcopal diocese? Why is it that you are here? Do you come to be because of some old disagreements with your brothers and sisters in Dallas over liturgy or women's ordinations or some great fork in the road in which you decided to be divided? Or maybe you began because of a rapidly expanding Dallas and Fort Worth area in the 1980s, and so, like the westward expansion, you came to be. Do you find yourselves here because of the recent disputes with the Episcopal Church on sexuality? Some idea that when the church itself found itself in a confluence with culture, there was troubled waters. Did you come to be in order to protect some past tradition, some past way of being, to be unmovable like a fort against the wild? Do you come to be out of great tragedy or great wrong, and so you need to erect barriers to protect yourselves from the rest of the world? Is your reason to be about reuniting yourself with property in order that you may go forward with all your congregations in some frontier idea to possess the land and have it for yourself. I wonder, what is the story that you tell one another? What is the narrative that you craft about who you are and whose you are? What do you tell the world about the reason for the Episcopal Church's existence in this part of Texas? What is the story that you tell yourself when you're tired, when you're exhausted because you have been laboring long? What do you tell yourself when you're ready to quit? Because each of these stories, you see, each of these narratives have some bit of truth in them. There is some part of them that works their way on our hearts and makes us feel like they're the whole story, but they're only broken shards of a past that does not exist anymore. But we tell ourselves the lie that if we hold on, maybe we will safely make our way down the river together. You are, though, the church. You are nothing less than the body of Christ in this place, and God has a mission for that body. The mission is reconciliation. The mission is love. The mission is forgiveness. The mission is mercy. The mission is grace. And God's mission has a church, and that is the Episcopal Diocese of Fort Worth. This is your sole purpose, is God's mission. You people in this place are the answer to God's prayer. You are the answer to God's prayer. Jesus looked out on a great mass of people. And he saw that they were hurting and they were hopeless. And they were in need of a Savior. They needed someone to care for them. Like sheep without a shepherd, he says. And the words in this scripture that I have to say, the English do not do them justice. Jesus is moved in his whole being as the confluence of God and the people in need come together. Two things that had seemed so divided, two forks so separate, and yet the reality in Jesus brings them smack dab into contact with one another and mixes them up. And Jesus is moved in his being and sees them for who they are, God's people, his people, the people he is to minister to. And I imagine he can see into the future, and he says, my gosh, what's going to happen? I will not always be with them. The bridegroom will not always be here. And he turns to his disciples. Maybe they're the 70 that he just sent out. They've been following him around. Maybe, I don't know who the crowd is over here, but they're the people who've been thinking they were doing his ministry. And he says, the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Now, I like the King James Version. He says, pray to the Lord of the harvest that he will send out laborers into that harvest. You pray. We're going to pray for laborers. You are the answer to that prayer, Diocese of Fort Worth. The harvest is plentiful. Pray for missionaries to go out. Now let me be clear, and I think we have to pause for a moment. Because sometimes, you see, we can get confused about this language because we're good Texans and good Americans. Sometimes we think that this is all about becoming bigger and having more and all of that. We're just from Texas, all of us are, and we just like to be bigger than everybody else. And so when you're small, you just kind of grates against you. And so we hear these words, why Jesus says, go out and be laborers in the harvest. Well, we're going to bring them all in, all 55. We're going to build 100. Who knows what we're going to do, but we're going to be bigger and better than we've ever been before. And that's what we say to ourselves. But that's not quite it either. I don't think you can read this passage. I don't think you can read any of Matthew's gospel, actually. And we're in the season of that reading right now on Sunday. But I don't think you can read any of Matthew's gospel without the cornerstone, that prophetic word, in Matthew 25. When he talks about the people who belong to the kingdom of God are the hungry and those who feed them, they are the naked and those who clothe them, they are the prisoners and those who visit them. And Jesus is very clear that this is what the kingdom of God looks like, people in need and people who serve them. And that is where the harvest ministry is. It is in the service of those in need. And a great multitude will be brought about as a confluence of those who have and those who have not come together. And they find out that they desperately need one another. And together they are the body of Christ. That is the great confluence of the gospel. That where the need is, we will find Jesus. All of us. And so your harvest is clothes and shelter for those who have none. You're to go out and harvest food for the people who are hungry. You're to harvest care and find ways of meeting the needs of those who are sick. You're to find harvest of peace for those who have none in the darkness of the night. You are to visit the prisoners. You are to visit the prisoners who are in jail, who are in prison, but you are to visit the prisoners of addiction and prisoners of loneliness. All those things that bind us, and you are to proclaim to them the year of the Lord's favor and that they are unbound. And I will tell you, this is not some platitude, for there are platitudes in the gospel. This is not a parable, and there are parables in the gospel. But Matthew 25 is a prophecy of what God intends the kingdom of God to look like. Matthew 25 is God's vision of how it will be. And God is praying that laborers will answer his call and go out into the fields of the Lord. You see, you are not responsible only for the little churches that you have, or the big churches that you have, or the churches meeting in this place or that place. You are responsible, as I see it from this vantage point, for all 24 counties in North Texas that make up the Diocese of Fort Worth, and you are responsible for reaching out and serving the people in all 24 of those counties. God has not intended you to be the servants of these islands in which you inhabit. The work is clear. Now, I'm a bishop, so I want to be, you know, before I get in trouble. Before I get into trouble. Yes, on Sunday you are to offer praise and worship in your churches. I don't want on Sunday morning you going up to your say, the last Sunday I'll be here. Thank you very much, the bishop said. I didn't have to ask. Not what I said. That's what we're supposed to do. We are to build goodly and godly communities of fellowship. We are to worship in sanctuary. We're to provide sanctuary, a rest stop for pilgrims on their journey. That is one of the things that we are to do. But as far as I can tell, there are 6 other days and 22 other hours that we as the disciples of Jesus Christ are supposed to be at work in the world. As far as I can tell, the gospel says, well, thank goodness you did your 2 hours of service there, Andy. I really am happy. 6:22. And Jesus didn't say, I'm glad you're here. Let me go get the people. Let me bring the harvest into the barn. Now, I don't know. I grew up in the city, so I don't know a lot about harvest time, but I'm pretty sure the farmer has to go out into the field. Jesus didn't tell him to wait, but Jesus turned every disciple into an apostle. That's why we read the Samuel Seabury lessons about apostleship. Everybody who follows is anointed with the Holy Spirit to go out. That is the meaning of what apostleship is. No disciple remains a disciple. Every disciple is formed and raised up and sent out into the world 6 days and 22 hours to be an apostle of the gospel of Jesus Christ in the world. And that is who you are, Episcopal Diocese of Fort Worth. The world is not in need of some old idea about church. But it is hungry. It is hopeless. It is scared and homeless. It is parentless and friendless. And it is praying that somebody will come soon, that somebody will speak out. That somebody will save them. You see, you are the answer to their prayers as well. Sometimes you and I need a little saving too. Sometimes we are a little hopeless. Sometimes we need somebody to say, go up on that bluff, you can see the kingdom a lot better up there. Sometimes in the midst of that, we want to close in on ourselves. We want to divide up the resources. We want to separate into our silos. We want to protect ourselves and our forts. And we'll say, we lie to ourselves, we'll say, well, that's a good idea, Bishop. We'll get to that someday. But that's not the God that we believe in doesn't kind of wait for us to get it all together. The God that we believe in doesn't wait for us to have it all together. Jesus doesn't wait for the world to get perfect before he comes and saves it. He saves us in our brokenness, in our hopelessness. We believe in a God who sends people out from the comfort of Ur into the wilderness to build altars. We believe in a God who gives strength to the weak. We believe in a God who says, I know this is a crazy idea, but I want you to go out there and build an ark so you can save my creation. We believe in a God who speaks in the darkness of the night and from fiery bushes. We believe in a God who speaks on the mountaintops and makes the earth quake with his voice. We believe in a God who sends people out to do his work for him. We believe in a God who speaks for those who cannot speak for themselves. We believe in a God who says, you may be in a desert, but we'll get out of here. Follow this fiery light. And I'm going to provide manna when you're hungry and water from the rocks when you're thirsty. But your job is to go out and to journey into that wilderness with me. We believe in a God who resurrects the dead and a God who breathes a Holy Spirit into dry bones. That's the kind of God that we believe in. And that is the God of the Episcopal Diocese of Fort Worth. That is your God. And that is the kind of God that is praying that you will rise up and you will go out. God is waiting for you. And God is praying for you to put your shoulders at the gospel plow in the Lord's vineyard. For the harvest is plentiful and is great, and the laborers are few. God is praying for you. Your brothers and sisters in the Episcopal Church and in the Diocese of Texas are praying for you. And for your people, we are praying, raise them up and give them a measure of your grace and send them out. But you are the ones. It is you to whom the voice is calling. You are the ones who are God's laborers. You. God bless you. Because you are the answer to God's prayers and the prayers of the world. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.